Without any further ado, let's get started with the December 2023 Wild Science webinar. Sean Lusk, as I mentioned, will be presenting on the Arkansas Cube. Sean's been with Arkansas Game and Fish for about 8 years, first six spent as a fisheries management biologist out of the Hot Springs Regional Office, in the last 2 years in more of an administrative role here in Little Rock. Sean received his undergrad degree in fisheries science from Virginia Tech and then a master's in fisheries management from Auburn University. Sean, the floor is yours. Take it away.
All right. Thanks, Trey. Let me go ahead. Can you guys see my screen and everything?
We got you, and it's in full screen mode. Looks great, Sean.
Perfect. Yeah, we've been doing this whole virtual presentations for 3 years now, but I still feel like I need to ask, can you guys hear me? Can I hear you? Can you see my screen? So that's probably not something that's going anywhere anytime soon, but... Okay, so one of the biggest threats that fish and wildlife populations across North America are facing is habitat degradation. And as a result of that, fish and wildlife agencies across the country are pouring a significant amount of time, effort, energy, and resources into habitat restoration. But one of the biggest challenges that we're facing is just sheer magnitude, just the sheer scale of this habitat degradation. And we'll use Arkansas as an example. A lot of our major bodies of water and rivers and wildlife management areas are thousands of acres and hundreds of miles, and they're largely managed by just a couple biologists. So it's an extremely daunting task for just a couple biologists to restore enough habitat to actually have a positive population level effect on fish and wildlife species. So because of that, we really have to start thinking outside the box in using more non-traditional methods to maximize our effort out there, to really have the most bang for our buck. And so for my presentation today, I'm going to be talking about one of these more non-traditional methods that we're using in Arkansas that we've termed the Arkansas Cube to help us reestablish habitat in large reservoirs. Now, before I start talking about the Arkansas Cube, it's important to first talk about why we ended up in a situation where we needed the Arkansas Cube in the first place. So this presentation, the plot of this presentation is going to be the Gray Lake in Southwest Arkansas. Now, the Gray Lake is an absolutely beautiful reservoir. It's 13,400 acres. It's deep, dendritic. It's mesooligotrophic, so it has really clear water. And it has an extremely diverse fish community. You can go from catching anything from 1 of 4 different species of black bass to crappie to catfish to walleye. And it's one of our 2 premier hybrid striped bass fisheries. Now, despite all of that, despite how diverse the fish community is, our average angler that fishes the Gray is primarily targeting black bass. And more specifically, they're targeting large black bass. Now, this fish was not caught in the Gray Lake. In fact, this is the Arkansas state record largemouth. But our anglers that fish the Gray want to catch fish that are more of this caliber, right? They want to catch really large individuals. Now, to produce fish of this caliber and just to have a healthy fishery in general, you really need 4 things to come together. You need to have the right forage base, both in terms of quality and quantity. You need to have the right genetics that are adapted to be in that area and have the genetic potential to reach these larger sizes. You need to have longevity. You know, if a fish gets caught at age 2 at 12 inches, it's not going to live to be 12 years old and reach 24 inches when it hits that trophy size. And last but certainly not least is you have to have the right habitat. And so you can think of these 4 components as kind of like the 4 legs of a stool. If you were to remove 1 leg of a 4-legged stool, that stool is going to fall over, right? It's going to collapse. Well, the exact same thing is going to happen to a fishery. And so for this presentation, we're really going to key in on the habitat component. Now, in the early 1970s, shortly after the Gray was impounded, it became heavily vegetated with the aquatic plant coontail. Now, coontail is native, and it's actually a pretty incredible plant. And it serves a number of fish species throughout their entire lives. It acts as really good nursery cover for juvenile fish. And as those fish reach larger sizes, it creates a lot of really good ambush places that these adult fish can use to more efficiently forage. Now, so we really like coontail. Coontail is number 1 fan. But as we left the 1970s and got into the early to mid 1990s, the plant community in DeGray shifted towards a lot of non-native. So we saw a lot of hydrilla, a lot of Eurasian milfoil, a lot of Brazilian elodea. Now, despite the fact that these plants are non-native, they still serve that same function as coontail in terms of providing nursery cover for juvenile fish and providing good ambush places for adult fish. So in the early 1990s, pretty much all through the 90s and into the early 2000s, if you were a fisherman or a fish, you were having a really good time with all this aquatic vegetation. However, through certain parts of the year, primarily the summertime, the average user of DeGray Lake is not an angler. It's a recreational boater. Now, if you're coming from surrounding states to come to DeGray Lake and you really don't care about fishing or fish or aquatic vegetation, you have a much different perspective on vegetation. You know, you're coming up to DeGray Lake to do cannonballs off the top of your houseboat. You really don't want there to be a lot of aquatic vegetation. And in fact, you view aquatic vegetation as kind of more of the green monster, right? You're doing your cannonballs and this vegetation's tickling your feet and grabbing your ankle. And so a lot of these recreational boaters really began to complain to the marina owners and the Corps of Engineers and the Arkansas Game and Fish Commission, and more or less demanding that they do something about the abundance of aquatic vegetation. Because by the late 90s, early 2000s, the vegetation on DeGray had really exploded, and there was a pretty thick band of vegetation around the entire lower end of the lake. So the Corps of Engineers and the Arkansas Game and Fish Commission did start taking measures to try to reduce the abundance of vegetation. There was never an intention to completely eradicate it, but to begin reducing some of that vegetation. So in the early to mid 2000s, the Corps of Engineers began introducing hydrilla leaf mining flies, common name pack flies. And so the way the pack fly works is the fly itself will lay eggs on a leaf of a hydrilla plant. The larvae will eventually hatch from those eggs and burrow into the leaves of the hydrilla plant. And over the course of three different larval stages, that larvae will eventually burrow into the stem of that hydrilla plant. Now, once it burrows into the stem, it'll kill the top of the plant. Okay. It doesn't kill the entire plant. It just kills the top. So it basically has kind of a topping effect. They're basically out there just mowing the grass, more or less. Now, this was not the first time that pack flies had been introduced into a reservoir in the Southeast. In fact, hydrilla leaf mining flies are pretty prevalent in states like Florida, Alabama, and Texas. And to date, there's no known reports of these pack flies completely eliminating all the hydrilla in a body of water. And we'll discuss that in a second for why they're not able to do that. Now, while the Corps of Engineers were introducing these pack flies, the Arkansas Game and Fish Commission stocked about a little less than one grass carp per acre. Now, grass carp are an herbivorous species, and a lot of the species that grass carp tend to feed on are species like hydrilla and Brazilian elodea, which again were the really prevalent species in the mid-90s to early 2000s. Now, by 2000, the aquatic vegetation in DeGray Lake was kind of hitting its peak. It was extremely prevalent. There was a thick mat of it on the lower end of the lake. If there was low water, a lot of the vegetation was matted out. But by 2011, nearly all of that vegetation had been completely eliminated, just completely gone. You know, there was a lot of complex cover, and now it was essentially a moonscape around that entire shoreline. Now, the interesting thing is the most common species that was out there was hydrilla. And hydrilla is often referred to as the super plant. Now, the reason why hydrilla is called the super plant is because once you get it established, it's nearly impossible to get rid of it. And part of the reason for that is it develops these little things called tubers that are under the sediment. And unless you kill that tuber, you're not killing the plant. You can do whatever you want to that plant, but you're not going to kill it unless you can neutralize that tuber. So the fact that thousands of acres of hydrilla had essentially been completely eliminated seemingly overnight was an extremely, extremely bizarre situation. And based off what I've told you so far, you know, a lot of people might say, okay, you know, it was the grass carp or it was the pack flies. And despite the fact that those two species probably did contribute to the near elimination of aquatic vegetation on the lake, the more likely culprit was actually major changes in lake level elevation. So what this figure is, this is the hydrograph of DeGray Lake. This black squiggly line represents the average lake level for DeGray between 1990 and 2007. And keep in mind that this is an average. During any given year, the lake level will fluctuate around this line. You know, if we have a major rain event, it'll be above the line. If we have a period of drought, it'll be below the line. Now, this dashed line represents what we consider full pool. So anything above that dashed line is high water. Anything below the dashed line is low water. Now, based off data that we've collected, the depths that typically can support aquatic vegetation are about 7 feet below full pool, all the way down to about 27 feet below full pool. So anything less than 27 feet, and there's just not enough sunlight penetration getting down there to encourage the growth of aquatic vegetation. And anything less than about 7 feet runs the risk of becoming up on the bank and exposed due to lower water in the late fall, early winter time frame. Now, beginning in 2008, we started to see a series of really crazy lake level changes. So this green line represents the lake level elevation for 2008. And I want to draw your attention to this event right here. Right at the beginning of the growing season, we saw a major rain event in the central Arkansas area that caused the Lake DeGray to really spike. It was 10 feet over a full pool. Now, in addition to all this rain, we also got a lot of runoff. And so what that did was it made the lake extremely turbid. So you can think of this as, imagine if during the growing season, early spring, if you were to go put a big tarp on your front yard for about a month, imagine what your grass would look like after that month. It's going to be mostly dead, right? And so we believe that's what happened to the lower end of those depths at DeGray Lake. Those depths, they were no longer getting the sunlight that they needed for the vegetation down there to continue growing. But with just 1 year of a lake event like that, it's really not a big deal. You know, once you remove that carp off or that tarp off your front yard, eventually your grass is going to grow back, right? So it's really not a huge cause for concern. But during 2009, once again, we saw another major rain event right smack dab in the middle of the growing season. So this wasn't at the beginning of the growing season. This was after those plants had already grown up and were smack dab in the middle of their growing season. And so once again, there is essentially just a big tarp across the Great Lake with just turbidity. So again, you know, using your yard analogy, imagine if 2 years in a row you put a big tarp on your front yard for about a month or so. It's going to have a pretty detrimental effect to the overall growth of your grass. Now, going into 2010, we saw something a little bit different. We didn't have those major rain events during the growing season, but we more or less ran into the opposite problem. When we got into the late fall, early winter time frame and into winter, the lake was experiencing a near drought-like conditions. And this was, there in 2010, it was near a lake level low record. And so the major issue here is, if you've ever been to DeGray, you'll notice that the banks are extremely shaley. And so as that water level is dropping out, the shale is more or less drying out. So what happened here is any of that vegetation above that water line became desiccated. And because this happened in the wintertime, it was exposed to freezing temperatures. Now, there's few things that you can do that are worse for aquatic vegetation than dry it out and then freeze it. And that's exactly what happened in 2010. And as such, we expect that, again, that vegetative depth was shrinking to just a relatively narrow band. Now, going into 2011, this was kind of the final nail in the coffin for a lot of that vegetation out there. Because at the beginning of the year, we were continuing these drought-like conditions. In 2011 was, I believe, the record lake level low for DeGray Lake. And so again, anything above that water line is dried out and continuing to deal with freezing conditions. And then again, right in the middle of the growing season, we saw another huge rain event that again, put that big tarp on your front yard, basically. And so 3 out of 4 years, imagine putting a big tarp on your front yard. It's going to be pretty rough on that grass, and as it was in DeGray. And then we ended 2011, you know, going into November with once again drought-like conditions. However, we still had a depth band that could still support aquatic vegetation. But keep in mind, when you have a lake that's as vegetated as what the gray was, it's going to support one heck of a biomass of herbivores. So now you have all these turtles and grass carp and other species that feed on vegetation, really hammering this relatively narrow band of vegetation. So essentially what happened was by 2011, all of that vegetation in DeGray, all that really complex cover that we talked about that is essential for a healthy fishery, was completely gone. And so getting back to this slide, you know, we had talked about our four-legged stool and how each one of these components was just as important as the other ones. Well, essentially what happened is we lost a leg of our stool. And just like the leg of that stool is going to cause that stool to collapse, well, this caused our fishery to collapse. And so what this figure is right here is this is our largemouth bass catch per hour, electrofishing catch per hour. So on the vertical axis, we have catch per hour. And then across the horizontal axis, we have year. Now, in 2011, that's when our vegetation really took that downturn. And we saw a precipitous decline in our overall catch rate. Now, this catch rate is indicative of what the population and the rest of the lake is looking at. So by 2019, it was pretty obvious that we needed some sort of massive action to try to save this fishery, because things were only getting worse and there is zero sign that any of this vegetation was rebounding. And so this is where things start to get interesting, where you have a major reservoir, right? You have 13,500 acre reservoir, and you have two biologists that basically need to revitalize the habitat at a lake-wide scale. And so at the time, we had no idea where to even start. So we decided a good starting place would be to reach out to the people that do this for a living. And the people that do this for a living are the Corps of Engineers Engineering Research and Development Center out of Lewisville, Texas. And so we reached out to this group of biologists, and we asked them to come up to DeGray, look at the situation. We gave them a background, and we asked them to write us a roadmap on how we can try to restore aquatic vegetation out there at a lake-wide scale with more or less just two biologists. And so they sent up Lindy Dodd. Now, Lindy is an absolutely brilliant biologist. And so she came up in July of 19, and she looked at the lake, and she more or less created a roadmap for us. And so we really took that roadmap to heart and followed everything that it told us that we needed to do. Now, the roadmap itself really revolved around developing what are called founder colonies. Now, the idea of a founder colony is you don't need to go out and establish vegetation around the entire lake. All you really need to do is get a small amount of vegetation established in a few key areas of the lake, right? Once you get that vegetation established, it'll start reproducing and start spreading naturally. And once you can tap into natural reproduction, that's when you see this exponential increase in the amount of available fishery cover out of the lake. Now, the issue was the theory of these founder colonies, although they are tried and proven, have primarily been used in bodies of water that only fluctuate a couple feet. But like we just talked about, DeGray fluctuates upwards of 25 feet depending on how wet the summer is and how dry the fall and winter is. And so the two biggest threats, as we've established, to getting vegetation to grow into gray is major changes in lake level elevation and herbivory. Now, fortunately, Lindy kind of likes to think outside the box, and she came up with a really cool idea of developing what she termed a tetrahedron. Now, a tetrahedron is essentially a structure it's a tetrahedron, right? And it's got floats on it. So the structure itself stays right at the surface, and then it's wrapped in fencing. So basically what this does is it protects your brood plants from major changes in lake level elevation and herbivory, which are the two biggest threats that we're dealing with on DeGray. And so at the time we looked at this tetrahedron, and to be honest with you, we couldn't figure out how we were going to make this shape. It's a pretty unique shape. We couldn't figure out how we were going to make this out of PVC pipe. So instead we modified the design a little bit and created a cube. And so was born the Arkansas cube. And I'd like to give a huge shout out to Kim Sparks. She's the one that basically took our design and digitized it, which has really made it a lot easier for describing what this structure actually looks like and how it's used. And so the structure itself is 3 feet by 3 feet by 1.5 feet. And so basically what you do is it floats out the surface. You fill it with a lot of native aquatic vegetation, in this case, coontail. And then you put these in areas that have a high potential of establishing aquatic vegetation. And this thing essentially functions as like a little pepper shaker, just throughout the growing season through wind and wave action. It's just sitting there just shaking out seeds and other reproductive structures that have the potential to establish vegetation in a given cove. So once we had built some of these, our next step was to talk to local anglers and identify areas that have historically always had a lot of aquatic vegetation. We decided that those areas probably have the best conditions and the highest probability of allowing us to establish this vegetation. So after talking to anglers, we identified 16 coves around DeGray Lake. And so at each one of these 16 coves, we deployed our Arkansas cubes. Now, unfortunately, due to just time and resources, we didn't have the ability to implement a monitoring component, which in addition to just putting these cubes out there, it's just as important to monitor what effect you're actually having to be able to make micro adjustments on how you can improve what you're doing. But fortunately for us, Scott Jones at the University of Arkansas Pine Bluff came swooping in, and he actually developed a monitoring protocol for us and has been monitoring the efficacy of these cubes over the last several years. So the way that Scott's been monitoring these is he goes into each one of these coves several times a year throughout the growing season, and he conducts a series of transects. And what he does is he uses down imaging, and he records that, and he's looking for the presence or absence of aquatic vegetation. And if he does identify aquatic vegetation, he categorizes it into one of three groups, either short, tall, or tall and dense. And then he'll launch an underwater camera to go down there and validate what species he's actually seeing. And from that, he's able to generate maps like what you see at the bottom of your screen. Now, these have been extremely important in helping us make informed decisions about, okay, which one of these cubes or which coves are actually becoming established with aquatic vegetation? Where does it seem like this is working? Where does it seem like this is not working? And from that, we can use that information to actually make informed decisions on where we should move cubes or where we should move them away from areas that aren't working and put them in cubes that we don't currently have them, but based off the data we've collected, should be working. So with the data that Scott's collected, it's difficult to infer what the vegetation looks like in between those transects. But fortunately, working with our GIS division, we are able to take a more quantitative approach to predicting the overall abundance of vegetation in these areas. So basically what we can do is we can use a method that they use to create kind of like a crime map, like heat maps. And from that, we can estimate the overall coverage of the various types of vegetation. And we can start to predict what is the abundance of vegetation around these coves. And because we've been doing this for a number of years, we can actually predict how much that vegetation has grown over that period of time, which starts to give us a lot more information on, once we put a cube in an area, how long does it take before that area becomes not only established, but is at a point that we can remove that cube and put it somewhere else. Because again, we're dealing with finite resources. We can't just put these cubes in every single one of these coves, right? So one of the questions you should be asking yourself at this point is, you know, we've been doing this since 2019. Are we actually starting to see any results from having these Arkansas cubes out there? So in 2022, Scott put together a summary report for what we had learned up to that point. He's collected the 2023 data, but I don't think he's finished analyzing it quite yet. So as of 2022, Scott had identified established coontail growing around 8 of the 16 enclosures. Now, there's no way that we can say definitively that, you know, this wasn't all just natural. You know, there's no way that we can say that if our cube wasn't there, that this coontail would be coming naturally established. But again, it's important to keep in mind that up until 2019, there had been absolutely zero sign of a vegetation rebounding. And then suddenly we put these Arkansas cubes in an area, and within a few years, there's established coontail that was growing in just adjacent to where that cube is actually located. So we do believe that we are having some influence in helping that aquatic vegetation rebound. Now, the big question is, okay, so we're starting to see some vegetation rebound. At what point do we expect to start seeing population level effects on some of our fish communities? And so I wanted to bring this figure back up. So again, in 2011, that's when we essentially went from heavy vegetation to complete moonscape. And then through all the way through 2019, we just saw that catch rate of largemouth bass just continuing to plummet. Now, in 2019, that's when we started beginning our vegetation work. That's when we really hit the Arkansas cubes hard, and we really got after habitat restoration. Now, we did get out an electrofish in 2021 and 2023, and we are seeing some pretty encouraging results. During those years, we saw a pretty substantial increase in the catch rate of largemouth bass. Now, again, there's no way that we can definitively say this is a direct result of our efforts in the Great Lake, but it is really encouraging that maybe we are having a population level impact. So far with all the work that we've done, we still have a really long way to go to fine tune this approach. But ultimately what we're trying to get to is get to a point where two biologists can roll into a lake, you know, a major lake that's just managed by two guys and two biologists, and put a couple of these cubes out there in key areas. I think the importance is key areas, get some vegetation established and start to have positive impacts on fish and wildlife populations. So with that, there's been a significant amount of people that have helped out with this project. I'd like to thank everyone at the Arkansas Game and Fish Commission that's helped out. I want to give a huge thanks to University of Arkansas at Pine Bluff. I mean, they really, really helped us out by taking over the monitoring component. I'd like to thank the Corps of Engineers for everything that they've done and helping us come up with this idea of the Arkansas Cube, and they've given us a significant amount of support. And in fact, we kind of handed the baton back off to them. They're going to be taking over this project on DeGray and expanding it to Greer's Ferry in Greeson. And ultimately, again, we're working towards getting to a point where we have just a protocol that we can give to a couple biologists that are able to have large scale impacts with relatively finite resources. So with that, I will take any questions.
Thank you so much, Sean. All right, who has questions for Sean? Sean, you mentioned Coontail. I know when we've come over to do some videos about this project, there were some other species. Have we sort of settled on or found, you know, something that's going to be better? And I know we're working with native plants, but are there any types of vegetation that seem to do better than others with this DeGray project?
Yeah, it definitely does. So in addition to the Arkansas Cube, the value of the Arkansas Cube in working with Coontail is Coontail doesn't actually have to be in sediment. It can live its life completely free floating. Now, we did have other enclosures that we experimented with, and I didn't have time to discuss those in this presentation, but there were pretty much Arkansas cubes on steroids, and they have rigid bottoms. And inside those, we had plants that do have to be in sediment, and those were eelgrass, sago pondweed, and American pondweed. And we've found that it's extremely easy to propagate eelgrass, but the turtles absolutely love that stuff. And there was a couple times where we got turtles into our enclosures, and I've never seen anything get mowed down like this over a relatively short period of time. But so far, we really haven't seen much success with the eelgrass, the sago pondweed, and the American pondweed, which, you know, that being said, we're so early into this thing, we're really not sure what the rate of establishment of those other species look like. For all we know, we may have really loaded up a bunch of seeds out there, and it just takes a couple of years before we really start to see those other species firing off. But as of right now, we have reason to believe that Coontail is kind of our bread and butter, mainly because when the lake was first established, Coontail did really well out there. So that kind of tells us, hey, if it's done well before, it should do well now also.
Is there any indication or any research, maybe in the future, maybe some of the stuff Scott Jones from UAPB is doing to understand what types of substrate in certain parts of the lake that like may be more conducive to, you know, giving us these blooms that we want? I mean, or helping this aquatic vegetation get established?
Yeah, so that's a fantastic question. And right now, a lot of the support that we're getting from the Corps of Engineers, they are doing that. They're taking a significant amount of measurements at each one of these locations to help us better understand what are the conditions that generally work better than others. You know, fortunately, we have some coves that are not working, and we have others that appear to be working really well, and we have everything in between. So it really gives us a good opportunity to go into these areas and identify, hey, this substrate type is essential. This slope type is essential. You know, there's a lot of variables that we really don't understand. You know, what's more important than others. Just as an example, and this is all anecdotal, but we have some of our enclosures are on the lower end of the lake, and they're in these coves that really don't have much for wind or wave action at all whatsoever. And the vegetation inside those enclosures really doesn't do very well. But in areas where you have a lot of wind and wave action, those coves do really well. So there's a lot more that we're learning about, you know, where can you basically maximize your effort? Where can you get the most bang for your buck?
Okay, anybody else got questions for Sean before we move on? Going once, going twice. Okay, Sean, thank you so much. Fascinating presentation, fascinating work. It's been interesting personally to come over there to DeGray and see what you're doing, and look forward to this being applied elsewhere. You mentioned Greeson and Greer's Ferry. It will be interesting to see how the vegetation takes off there. Thank you so much, Sean.
Thank you.
All right, moving on. Our next presenter is Casey Brewster, and he'll be talking to us about conservation of eastern collared lizards in Arkansas. Casey is a Tillman Military Scholar, a Purple Heart recipient, and current postdoc at the University of Arkansas in the Arkansas Conservation and Molecular Ecology Lab. Casey completed his PhD dissertation in Dr. Steve Beaupre's lab fall of 2019, titled Eastern Collared Lizard: Population Declines in Ozark Landscapes, an Assessment of Operative Environmental Constraints. Casey's postdoc research includes diversity of smallmouth bass in Arkansas. He's the biology coordinator and biology instructor at Northwest Arkansas Community College, and a part-time conservation technician and feral swine technician with the Game and Fish Commission. In 2018, it's kind of a little side note, Casey founded a nonprofit organization, Snake Mountain Pack Goats, that's focused on providing outdoor guide service and animal therapy through goats for military veterans and first responders. The nonprofit project allows Casey the opportunity to partner with local conservation organizations and other field biologists to improve accessibility to backcountry areas in Arkansas. And now, with more on the conservation of the eastern collared lizard in Arkansas, Casey Brewster.
All right, very good. Thank you, Trey. So, I am Casey Brewster, and the main thing I want to talk to you about is this conservation project, essentially, that's focused on all things revolving around conservation of the eastern collared lizard in Arkansas. So next slide. All right, so the eastern collared lizard is a large-bodied, very conspicuously colored rock habitat, xeric, hot, open space, adapted species that is common really throughout the desert southwest and sort of the rockier edges of, or the face of mountains going up on wide open sort of desert type areas. Arkansas, Missouri represents the eastern portion of its range, where it's restricted to more or less of what we call glade habitat. So xeric limestone prairies and sandstone and dolomite bedrock, sort of bedrock interface with prairie habitats. And these habitats, a lot of folks don't realize, were historically extremely common throughout the interior highlands. A couple centuries of fire suppression has resulted in substantial woody vegetation encroachment over much of these habitats, pushing those habitats. So on your slide here, the two habitats on the left, that would be sort of a glade and a prairie. And that's usually what we think of that interface, that what they're naturally supposed to look like. And fire suppression and woody vegetation encroachment has pushed them to resemble more of those habitats more on the right, which means that we've lost a lot of those glade endemic species, those species that really are adapted for glade habitats. And one of those species is the eastern collared lizard, which is considered a species of special concern in Arkansas and Missouri. And so the first question we want to address is, what's so special about glade ecosystems. What's so special about glades and the glade community and the eastern collared lizard? There's a couple of different ways we can address that. One way that I really like to is sort of thinking from an ecological diversity standpoint. So the first thing we would consider would be the abiotic diversity. Next slide. So your abiotic diversity would be those things associated with the diversity of the habitat that are not, that don't revolve around living things, the non-living parts of it. And there's lots of different things you could think of, the geologic variation or diversity, the mineral and substrate that's very different about a glade, a functional glade compared to the rest of the Ozarks ecosystems or interior highlands. Physical attributes of open habitat, allowing a lot more sunlight in, being substantially hotter, more faster draining type substrate, rockier substrate. The substrate just in general is going to be substantially different than just about any other landscape or ecosystem across interior highlands. Anybody who spent much time working in the summer months in glade habitats would recognize that that's probably our hottest ecosystem in this area, because you know, essentially you're dealing with rock that heats up throughout the day, and later in the day, if you have no canopy cover, no shade, it can get really hot in those habitats. And then with all of these things that we're mentioning, the ecosystem functions are going to be substantially different in a glade, a functional glade ecosystem, compared to just about any other ecosystem. All right, so next slide. And so then the other side of that would be the biotic diversity, the biotic being the living things. And so there's lots of things we can think of here. The first thing to point out is the diversity of the glade community itself. In terms of biodiversity hotspots, how diverse, how many different species functionally intertwine and work together, glades would be about, you know, they would be really high up there in terms of just overall biodiversity. And those glade habitats have a lot of rare, uncommon, and endemic species, going from several different glade plants, things like milkweed, coneflower, blue stem, rock pink, and then a lot of different endemic and or rare glade arthropods. So, for example, lichen grasshoppers, tarantulas, and a host of really important critical pollinators, several different butterfly species and so on and so forth. And then of course the vertebrate species that either call it home, really do well in it, or actually require those type of habitats. And one of those being the eastern collared lizard, the main one that we're primarily focused on with this project. And the eastern collared lizard is a top predator in those glade habitats, and it's been shown that they have a really strong, important role in the glade community, so much so that a glade community without, in this part of the range, a glade community without eastern collared lizards would not be functioning properly because it wouldn't have its top predator. So that would be the biotic and abiotic, but maybe there's other things that would be just as important. So next slide. I think another one that's really important to a lot of Arkansans is the importance of functional, healthy, good quality glade ecosystems to native game species. So a lot of native ground nesting birds, specifically northern bobwhite quail and wild turkey. This habitat ends up being really important, very helpful for helping, especially for younger, you know, for the younger age classes, for brooding cover and feeding cover and so on and so forth. So lots of different things make this habitat and a community that's associated with the entire ecosystem a really important part of the diversity and the larger landscape of the Ozarks and the interior highlands in general. Next slide. All right, and so with that, over the last couple of centuries, we've seen a huge decline in the loss of the quality and quantity of glade habitats, and with that, a huge loss in the quality and decline of collared lizard populations. So the red X's on here would be populations that have known to that we've lost in the past 30 or 40 years. So a huge decline, a huge loss to functioning ecosystems because of that key glade predator is missing off those landscapes. Next slide. All right, so I know a lot of folks may be interested in exactly what is it about the loss of these glade habitats that's causing population declines. What is the actual mechanisms causing these population declines? And I would love to talk about that here, but it would sort of take a little bit more time than we want to get into. So I encourage you, if you are interested in the mechanisms and really what causes these population declines, to check out this paper in the American Naturalist, but sort of summarize and give the bottom line, the most important things for this talk is that as we've had woody vegetation encroachment, this has changed the abiotic environments, more notably the amount of shade, the amount of canopy cover, and ultimately leads to lower fecundity rates, and then ultimately leads to population declines. Those populations keep getting smaller and smaller and going toward extirpation. So the first and most important thing for reversing this and conserving glade ecosystems and the collared lizard is to restore interior highland glades. So actively managing for prescribed fire, removing cedar, and several other things that goes along with improving those habitats. But for us to restore the glades like they were, many of these habitats, even if they're restored, aren't going to just magically lizards pop up. They don't migrate, you know, super far through most of the Ozark landscapes. You know, if it's very thick forest, they're not going to migrate and move into those habitats on their own. So this requires population management. Population management in the aspect of reintroductions and population supplementation. So that is a lot of the main goals of the collared lizard project that I'm speaking of. Next slide. Which brings us to the collared lizard conservation team. So this is sort of the partnership between several different agencies, including the Arkansas Game and Fish Commission, where our main goal is all things revolving around collared lizard conservation. We have a website. We're kind of just getting this thing kicked off the ground, but we have a lot of partners and a lot of different approaches, sort of trying to be comprehensive as much as possible to addressing and improving glade habitat and collared lizard conservation. Next slide. So the first thing I want to talk about is the captive propagation program. So the captive propagation program is focused on breeding lizards in a sort of indoor facility or semi-outdoor. They spend part of their time outside and part of the time inside. And this is a partnership with AGFC and the Little Rock Zoo. So Little Rock Zoo has some breeding colonies of collared lizards from Arkansas that we make sure that they have enough adults, and then they allow those lizards to breed and give us a bunch of babies, and then we have those babies for reintroducing the next year. When they're 1 year old, then we're able to take them to sites that are restored and marked for reintroduction. Next slide. So here would be pictures of some of the breeding. On the right-hand side is a breeding facility. That's myself and Kelly Irwin, the state herpetologist, working on some of the breeding enclosures. And on the left-hand side, they have the outdoor exhibit for folks to see. And this is really cool if you get a chance to go during the activity season of collared lizards. So maybe late April through early October, you know, late September, they have a handful of adults. One adult male and usually a couple of adult females that are out here, and what they've done is as best as possible mimicking a small glade, but having it enclosed so that lizards don't run away or get eaten. So a really cool exhibit there with the Little Rock Zoo. Next slide. All right, and so captive propagation is a really good way to get us numbers, gives us large numbers of lizards, because we sort of make sure that those lizards have a head start. They don't have predators dealing with them, and so we get really high numbers. But as most of you can imagine, captive animals don't always do as well whenever moved to a new spot as a wild-caught animal. So we have some habitat areas where we are purposely trying to get grow a really good population of lizards. And then once we get those populations where they need to be, then that gives us the chance to restock with some wild caught animals, which would typically be more robust. So the wild propagation program is a really important part of this component, although it's not something that, you know, is cool that we can, you know, take kids to and go look at like the zoo in terms of the functionality to the project is extremely important. Next slide. And so then that comes with reintroductions. So these three animals would all be examples of lizards that were reintroduced. In fact, these were all taken by Levi Harrell. The pictures were taken by Levi on reintroduction this past year. So next slide. And so they were reintroduced on some Arkansas Game and Fish lands in Arkansas. And actually, this would mark the first time we've done reintroductions using the captive animals. So we've been doing some wild-caught relocations and reintroductions and had some success there. But this will be the first time we've done some reintroductions with the captive animals. And so the idea is the first year we'll reintroduce the captive animals. As we mentioned, they're probably not quite as robust, and maybe you won't have like, you know, super high survival rates, but you hope that a handful of those animals sort of make a good stronghold. You have some females that are sort of picking up and making their own territories. And then the next year you reintroduce some wild caught animals. And now you hopefully can get this population up and going. And so this would be an example of a restored glade in Arkansas that at one time had collared lizards. And hopefully now and then in the near future, we'll once again have collared lizards. Next slide. And so another important part of the collared lizard conservation team is population monitoring. So it's really important that we monitor those populations. And there's several things we can do, just, you know, looking at overall densities and population structure. If you do get a chance to go back and look at some of the papers that have come from this project and from my dissertation on what is affecting these populations, you'll see that one really important indicator is the growth rate of these animals. And so that's a really important part of monitoring these populations, to see how well they're growing. In general, a faster growing, larger animal is gonna be healthier and have better success than a population of animals that's defined by slower growing, smaller animals. Next slide. And then, of course, obviously a really good indicator that a population is on its way is gravid females. So on the top left, you'd have a female that looks like she's about ready to pop, full of eggs. And then, of course, even better than that would be that there was a bunch of hatchlings running around on the ground. So on the bottom right would be some baby, we call them bobbleheads, because they're usually, their heads are quite a bit bigger than their bodies for a handful of days until they get enough meals in them. So having several little hatchlings run around the ground is a really good indicator that the population's on its way. Next slide. Okay, and then another really important part of the project is future monitoring for long term, and especially being able to determine what's going on in terms of those captive animals or wild caught animals. Of course, they don't always come from the same place. Sometimes there's a mix of those animals. So being able to determine which have the best survival and which ones have the best reproductive success, and sort of making sure that we keep our gene pools, with relatively decent genetic diversity in these reintroduced sites. And so to understand that, you need to know what our native sites have. So there's sort of a larger population genetic study going on in the background with this project as well. So next slide. All right, and so another important part of the collared lizard conservation team is being able to help land managers, whether that be private landowners, Forest Service, or Game and Fish, or anyone that has glade habitat, helping them understand where they would rank in terms of priority. How much potential does a glade have? If you're going to go and work on restoring it, you're planning on putting a bunch of money in it, but want to know what the chances are that it would hold collared lizards, or is the site's has the management efforts brought it to a point where we can reintroduce lizards? So it's sort of this habitat quality assessments that we do. Next slide. All right, and so an important part of the study that I have referred to The American Naturalist, was trying to understand those mechanisms and what's causing these population declines. And I feel that the models that I came up with and the approaches that I did were outstanding and really important for understanding the real mechanisms causing these population declines. But the models that I worked on in my PhD were really specific to the timeline and the data and the individuals and the actual sites that I was working on, and not super helpful, or they really needed a lot of work before you could apply them to just about any situation. Say, you know, we have a restored site and can we use that data and sort of model and predict the potential of a new site? So that is where individual-based modeling comes in. Next slide. So a partnership with Matt Gifford, who is also part of the collared lizard conservation team, and some of his grad students have taken some of my models, some of my dissertation work, and applied them to individual-based models where they can do a lot more tweaking and determining which parameters are going to have major effects. And so there's some really cool stuff coming out of that lab. They've done some presentations that I'm really excited about that's really going to move this part of the research part of the efforts that we're working on forward. Next slide. And probably the one that I'm most interested in revolves around rock refugia. So one of the biggest things that we, I would say probably about 50% of the time, whenever we go to a site that is getting close to after land management's had several burns and cedar removal and has some potential, a lot of our glades have had the rock removed, or maybe it never had enough rock. And as you remember, or as I mentioned, the eastern collared lizard is a rock-adapted species. It really needs large boulders. They do really well in boulder fields and so on and so forth. So trying to determine the impact of what amount of refugia, rock refugia, is there and how that is going to affect the population and how much potential it has on the population in the future is a really important thing. And Matt Gifford and some of his grad students have been doing that with their individual-based model to help us better understand if we went out there and adjusted the rocks, how that, or how many rocks and how much rock refugia, how that would impact the site. And that's going to be really important in the future whenever we're looking at saying that a site is actually ready or does it need some rock brought in, you know, to sort of supplement the amount of rock that's there, the amount of boulders and so on and so forth. So really exciting research going on there. Next slide. All right. So collared lizard conservation team, like I said, we do, we sort of have a lot of different parts to it. There's a lot, several different partners. So in summary, glade habitat quality assessments, consulting, and in certain situations, some active restoration with some state wildlife grants with the game and fish that we're working on. The captive propagation program and the wild propagation program. Both of those together gives us the animals that's needed to reintroduce new sites as those glade sites are being restored across the state. And then population management for in the future. So reintroductions themselves and supplementation. And then, of course, population monitoring, making sure those populations are doing well. If they're not doing well, what's going on? And being able to try to actively do something about it, stay proactive on these populations over time. And then, of course, a huge component of this project is research and continuing to figure out ways that we can address questions that help us better predict and understand what's going on with glade communities and glade ecosystems and collared lizards themselves. Next slide. All right. So with that, I'd like to thank the funding agencies, primarily the Arkansas Game and Fish Commission and a handful of private donors, our many agency partners, partners specifically from U of A and UCA that help with sort of the genetics and a lot of the research. The Arkansas Game and Fish Commission obviously has been a huge part of this since from day one and slowly helping this thing come together. U.S. Forest Service has played in a really important role. A lot of the glade habitats that still have collared lizards are on Forest Service, so we're definitely a really important partnership with Forest Service. And then, of course, our Little Rock Zoo partners and making sure that we are continuously getting baby lizards in the future to help supplement our numbers whenever we do reintroductions. Next slide. All right. So with that, I leave you with my my collar lizard conservation motto, saving the world one lizard at a time. And I'll open this up for any questions.
Thank you, Casey. And thank you to Chris Madoff for the assist and presenting the slides today and for quick thinking on the feet there, Chris. Appreciate that. Okay, who has questions for Casey regarding conservation of eastern collared lizards in Arkansas? Casey, while others may be formulating questions, I want to get back and ask one related to one of your early slides. One of the concerns with the population decline of the species is you mentioned the ramifications that may have for glade ecosystem degradation. What are some of the consequences either that we've witnessed or potential consequences of the decline or extirpation of this species from these unique habitat types?
There's a lot of different approaches you could take there. You know, I think one of the biggest things is, you know, the majority of Arkansans probably, you know, depending on their age, don't even remember what a good functioning you know, interior highlands glade looks like, you know, from bottom to top, what they're supposed to, because there's just not that many operating like they are. So the fear or the problems with Arkansans not even knowing what used to not that long ago in terms of, you know, in the greater scheme of things, not very long ago was highly biodiverse habitats that were sprinkled all across interior highlands are now really rare and essentially don't look like they used to. That would be one. Obviously, pollinators. There's a lot of native pollinators that the core plants that they really rely upon are associated with these glade and prairie habitats. And whenever we lose those plant species, which is a huge loss in by itself, but you don't just lose the plants, the rare plants themselves. You lose that sort of interconnected, you know, pollinators and the individuals that rely on those and sort of being replaced by non-native invasive species. Now, you know, the thing to recognize is a lot of these glades nowadays make a good forest. They look good, but we're not we're not limited by the amount of functioning forest across, say, the Ozarks, right? Most of the Ozarks has lots of examples of really good functioning natural forest, but part of those forests weren't, you know, originally forests. There were xeric limestone prairies and glades and savanna open prairie lands anyway.
Thanks, Casey. All right, anybody else? Any more questions for Casey before we wrap this thing up? Okay. Seeing or hearing no other questions, we will shut her down. Casey, thank you so much. And Sean Lusk has already signed off. Thank you. A couple of great presentations. Really enjoyed having Casey on the Arkansas Wildlife Podcast not too long ago. And if you want to hear a little more discussion about his work with eastern collared lizards, I would encourage you to check that out if you haven't already. Thank you to everybody for tuning in for the December 2023 Wild Science webinar from the Arkansas Game and Fish Commission. We'll be back next month in January with another rendition of it. Take care, everybody.